Hey, Sashan, what's going on? Saw this video in my suggested viewing. And the 8-bit home computer from 1975, you've never heard of. Now, I saw the picture of it and I thought, I programmed on one of those before? Maybe not this exact model, but let's see.
Well, hello everyone, and welcome back to Adrian's Digital Basement. On today's video, we're going back in time a little bit to take a look at this machine, the Southwest Technical Products 6800 computer system. Gotta make sure I say the name right. I recently had a video on the second channel where I showed a really old.
This looks like a G4 Mac turned on its side. What is this?
Potentially kit slash homemade slash made by a company, but a one-off computer that was given to me. And if you haven't seen that video, it's kind of interesting. I'm still trying to figure out what the details around that computer are. And actually, by the time you see this video, I may already know a little bit about that machine. But unlike that one-off computer, this machine here is actually somewhat historical of a computer. But yet, it's something I had never personally ever heard of until just the other day, actually, and then I ended up with one of them. So without further ado, let's take a closer look at this thing and see if I can even get it working. I mentioned in the intro that I thought this computer was historical, and when you think about computers that.
It's just old. 6800, if it's the 6800 I know, it was a blip. It was just a blip. The 6809 came later, and it was less of a blip.
Are known in history to be significant or groundbreaking in the realm of home computing, it all goes back to the original Altair. Before the Altair, computers were pretty much relegated to companies or universities or governments and not really to the home. So when Al
Yeah, this, some guy in a garage makes a computer, he wants to sell it. High schools bought this thing back in the day. Usually as a kit, your computer club at your high school usually had some sort of a science teacher who would help put the thing together. They would do little programs on the thing. It helped if you had a CRT or something hooked up to it with a keyboard, because you can't really do anything with it. This is just the box, right? It's just a box.
Altair released that first kit computer, it really was quite revolutionary. But it wasn't long after the Altair came out that other kit computers came out on the market for home users.
And this is the one from War Games, starring Ferris Bueller.
From my understanding, it was only about 6 months later that the IMSI 8080 came out, which was actually really just an Altair clone. But this was another machine that came out around 6 months after the Altair did. So it was in later 1975.
Yeah, there's the terminal for it right there. Dun da da da. Yeah, you had to put together the terminal too. That was fun.
The Southwest Technical Products Corporation, that's their logo right there, released this machine, the 6800 computer system. Unlike the Altair and the IMSI, this actually uses the Motorola 6800 8-bit microprocessor. The Motorola chip in this.
I didn't like the 6800 when it came out. I was more of a 7, not 7, a Z80. I was a Z80 nut bit at the time. Later on, I would find out the Z80 sucked. Sucked ass. Blue balls. It blew ass or sucked balls, one of the two. Z80, I hated it. That's what the Sinclair ZX1. Trying to program a Sinclair ZX1 in assembly language, I hated it. I hated it. But I didn't like the 6800 either all that much. And don't get me started on the 6502, please.
Very much like the Intel chip, was an 8-bit processor. It supported 64K of RAM and was relatively groundbreaking for its capabilities, but also its low cost. Now there's one big obvious.
I think they're like $499 for the system, depending on how much RAM you got for it and what, you know, it had cards that you would put inside the thing. Did you want to print? Here's a card. Did you want to hook it up to a to a card punch tape? Here's a card. Did you want to connect it? You know, they didn't have mouse. They didn't have separate keyboards back then. You could get a serial board for it. And the serial board basically hooked to your phone. You call on your phone, you plug your phone into the thing. Acoustic coupler thing, nonsense.
The difference between this computer and the MSI and the Altair, of course, is the front panel is really pretty boring looking, having just a power button and a reset switch here.
Yeah.
This clear part of the case here is actually just that. It doesn't actually have any lights or anything behind it. So this is it.
Oh my God. Well, my black case, solid black, no plastic. If I put the lid on my case, I can't see the computer in the dark. It has lights. It came with lights, but I don't turn on the lights. I don't much care for the lights. There's enough blinding light coming from my video card as it is.
For this computer. Now, while the blank front plate on this is a little less sexy than the one on the other machines, this computer...
Oh, look at this board. Look at this thing he's got. He's got the anti-static mat thing. Do you think he uses it properly? Like, does he have the wristband attached to the corner of the mat? Does he do that when he... Does he ground himself before he begins opening these things up?
Actually was a lot more functional in that all of the control of the computer was done through a serial port on the back, which you would combine with a terminal or a teletype so that you didn't have to be flipping switches to load...
Yeah, you hook up the speaker and you'd hear... You know, you would hear I can't do the voice. I don't have voice mod running, but anyone who's watched Colossus, the Forbin Project, remember the computer's voice in that movie? That's what this thing would sound like when it talked.
Programs, you could actually directly load programs off of paper tape or even cassette with an adapter through that serial port. Later versions of Altair's computers and pretty much all the other kit-type computers that came out after this also had the ROM-based monitor with the serial port and did away with all...
And at the same time as this, well, maybe 3 years before this, Heathkit had these little kits, really cool things. Kids could follow the instructions like Lego. You snap the diodes and the transistors and the resistors and everything. You can make an AM radio. You can make a burglar alarm system. You could make a rain detector. I guess somehow it detected if it was raining outside. I wish I kept that thing, because those things sell for a fortune. Now, if I wanted to rebuy a Heathkit electronics kit from 1970, now, to do that now. How much? The kits back then cost, I think, $10 in 1970 money. Now, used but still in good shape, $1,000. $1,000 for something that can barely do what your phone does. You know, you stick the phone to your forehead basically, and it tells you how many days you have left to live just from your phone.
All those front panel switches. Now, this particular computer was actually saved from going to e-waste and given to me, and I think a lot of the reason why it was on...
No such thing as e-waste. it goes to Mexico. Let them deal with it.
Almost sent to e-waste because it doesn't have that sex appeal that those other machines have, nor the cachet or like the notoriety, so that someone looking at this computer might not realize what it is and just toss it out. Now, this particular example is a little bit rough and ready in the condition department. The front panel is actually not that bad. It's missing a metal.
Oh my God, he's stretching this out forever. He's gonna talk for 5 minutes about the front panel. What's the back look like?
Oh. Flipping the computer around to the back, we have two DB25s here, one labeled control, one labeled nothing, two extra spots for DB25s, and then...
Well, one could be the printer. The control. Well, I don't remember holes like this in the back. I'm guessing we left ours closed. Is that it? Maybe these are closed. They could be closed. It's hard to tell.
Four holes that you can run cables through, I guess.
And the power. No, these are open. It's got this weird light coming down inside. You can see a couple cards in there. Control is a control. You know, it's the. What did they call those things back then? We called them CRTs. But before that, they were called. Get to the control panel now! Who has control of the machine? I've lost control.
Power cable.
I mean, no one. Whoever stuck this on the back here, that was their lingo back in the day.
I need
control of this machine. Give me control access. That's how people talked, if I remember right. People from World War II.
Through the back like that. It's too prong. It's not even grounded, but this was the old days. It's not like there was any kind of RF shielding on this machine or any kind of safety whatsoever.
It had an FCC thing. That's all you needed back then. There was UL listing, sort of. I mean, it was made in some guy's house. He probably used his toaster, the power cord from his toaster.
However, actually, and just like the Altair, this machine here was sold only as a kit. So you could buy all the parts to make this, and you got the case, and all the circuit boards, and the power supply and whatnot.
It's not like you were gonna be using this your whole entire life. This was a summer project that you did. Then you went to college, you learned the real McCoy. The next summer, you would order a Apple. You got yourself an Apple II computer. That's how it worked. Unless you were a CPM Nazi. Then you would get a North Star machine.
But you still had to put it together yourself.
If you were one of those weirdos down the street who drove a Mercedes and your brother was a dentist, and you thought it might be cool to get them the Osborne 1 computer in a suitcase. Let's get one of those. We'll write it off as a, you know, tax write-off.
It meant that you included all the ICs, the circuit board, stuff like that, but you had to do all the soldering yourself. But one thing about this machine compared to the Altair, which was pretty significant.
Quit comparing it to the Altair already. Shoot me now. Okay, here's some guts to it.
Southwest Technical Products Corporation did actually sell a computer terminal kit, and it was $275, so definitely not cheap at all. And here is a picture of that assembled kit, which is actually an iteration on the original TV typewriter, which was pretty much the very first device in 1973.
How? Let me in, how? Yeah, got the wood grain case, semi case. Man, talk about homebrew. You know, any kid in the 70s belonged to a homebrew club. You got your newsletters from Bill Gates and Steve Jobs back then, Steve Wozniak. And their clubs would be full of this kind of crap and garbage. People putting junk parts together in their garage. And they would show up to a home brew club to, you know, show off their latest thing. Look what I can do. It's only black and white, but I plan to do a color version of this one day.
Pretty much the very first device in 1973, which let you hook a computer, or at least a keyboard, up to a monitor and see text displayed on it.
Now, I had a monitor like this. That's what I hooked my Sinclair up to. It wasn't a Sanyo. It was, I think it was Hitachi. I had a Hitachi black and white TV. Worked great for the Sinclair.
From my understanding, one of the big improvements on this later version was that you used static RAM as opposed to shift registered, which allowed you to move the cursor around and edit any part of the screen.
Yeah.
One other thing to consider is that this kit did not include any kind of monitor or CRT. You had to use your TV set or a security camera monitor like seen here. Now, if we add the price of the terminal kit to the 6800 computer, it was $770, which was more than the Altair with the 4K of RAM. But remember, for $693 for the Altair, you're still getting a computer where you have to interact with it through the front panel, and that's it.
That's it.
Meanwhile, on the 68.
Yeah, the other computers had your bit on and off bit switches on the front with the blinking light. This was more sophisticated.
For $770, you got a computer that actually had a keyboard and a monitor while you hook it up.
Look, this is a different case than what he's got. Like, it's like the assembly line would change in just weeks. Oh, let's make a change in the design. Oh, we can't get from that manufacturer anymore. We have to order parts from another guy who makes cabinets. Okay, so now the computer looks like this in our catalog.
To a monitor, and then you can interact with it with a keyboard, which was much more how we expect to use computers even today.
Now that we know a little bit about this machine, let's open this thing up, take a look inside. Now, normally there are, I think, 14 screws that hold the top cover on. And of course, that trim piece is installed on the front and back, which completes the look and also makes it a little bit less sharp along the edges.
I mean, the reason why there's holes drilled into this mesh here, the whole point of having this grill is so when an atomic bomb hits your house, the data on your computer is pristine. Nothing can go wrong.
No,
I don't know what this is for. Probably to let heat out of the thing while it's turned on. But no, I was right the first time. It is actually to prevent EMPs to fucking destroy your most secure data in the house.
I only have two screws installed in here because when I got this computer, it didn't have any screws installed in it whatsoever. The machine itself was actually in pretty rough shape. It was very dirty, and there's definitely evidence that this was stored in a, let's say, less than ideal environment. Since this machine has been in the basement, all I've done to it is...
It was stored... Oh yeah, it is kind of messed up on the bottom. Look how many boards it's got. I want to know what this one is. What's this one? What is this? What is this?
Is clean it up a little bit because it was really quite dirty. The power supply section here, you can see there's quite a bit of rust on the transformer. And of course, the fact that the case is open on the top means that any kind of moisture or dirt or whatever can fall straight down into this. So this is obviously rusted over time. It shouldn't cause a problem though. And if this computer ends up working well, I can take the power supply.
No, this is just the heat sink. That's all that is. That'll burn right off. It'll be nice and mercury silver, right? When it's turned on.
Out or take this transformer out and give it a little coating of rust converter.
I'd watch out for this thing here. This is the radioactive isotope. U-370. You don't even... if you look directly at it, you're already dead.
And then black spray paint. The way this power supply works, it's very common for machines of this era. The mains comes in, it's reduced to a lower AC voltage. There's a bridge rectifier right here that's mounted upside down onto the chest.
These are the same cables you find inside your Zenith television set. Man. I need to cut the green wire. What if you're colorblind? I need to cut the green wire. Which one's green?
Assy. The output of that is DC, and it goes into this large filter capacitor here, which then feeds to this board, which makes its way to the power connector, which is currently unplugged. It's right here.
Oh, there's a fuse.
And that's what goes to the motherboard.
There's a fuse.
The large cap is produced.
So basically, all this here, including these guys here, this is your power supply. This part of the case is the power supply. And airing out his dirty laundry is the power supply here. Where's the fan?
Seeing around roughly 8 volts unregulated DC, which when it gets to the motherboard and these cards, they have voltage regulators on them that bring it down to the 5 volts. And this little board also has 4 diodes and 2 capacitors on it along with this fuse. And this generates a plus 12 and a minus 12 volt unregulated DC. And that goes to the motherboard as well through the power connector right here. That would almost certainly be for serial lines or any other.
These look like connectors you'd find in the dashboard of your Ford Pinto going to your AM FM radio.
Chips that need like a plus 12 or a minus 5, and they would use voltage regulators on those boards locally to actually generate those.
Okay. Does it turn on? Does it boot up? Does it make the chime when it boots? Oh my God, why do they have to do this? Explain it like I'm 12, what this thing is. Oh my God, did you ever turn the fucking thing on? No! He didn't. The whole point of... What's he doing with his phone? What is that about? According to my phone, you can order these parts from Egghead Software, circa 2001. Archive.org.
A quick Google search does reveal that the 74S474 that is on this board right here is indeed a 4 kilobit PROM. I'm pretty sure that's 4 kilobit.
Oh my goodness.
Yep, 512 bytes by 8 bits, bipolar PROM. That means that you could just execute code straight out of this and it's only 512 bytes in size, which isn't a whole lot. But I wouldn't be surprised if this is mapped to the C000 address space, so you can just go right to it to start booting your floppy disks.
I spent some time Googling for the manual for this particular disk controller card, but I actually couldn't find it. I did find this advertisement for it.
Well, it's going to be a third party that's going to make the drives. Third parties made the printers. Our basic floppy disk system. What company is this? Super Software. Who's the company? I don't see the company name. Usually it says Buffalo, New York, you know. 010012, that's the zip code, you know, something like that.
It looks like it came with this external drive chassis. It does mention here it has a built-in ROM for booting right off your floppy disk.
Okay. This is driving me nuts, guy. You're reading like a Ford Pinto advertisement in the LA Times. And it's telling you stuff like, comes with seatbelts. Has a cigarette lighter, 2-door, 3-door models, manual shift, you know, manual stick, it's like reading a thing and it says 4-wheel car. Single engine motor, you know, get to the stuff.
The problem is, it seems to indicate there are
68,000 computer system. What a mouthful that is. In the next video, I'll be diving into this machine.
Oh my God, next video. This is from a year ago. Did he do it? I don't feel like looking for it. Man. Anyway, I've heard of it. I programmed on the fucking thing back in 1978, I think it was. It was fun, but there were better. Radio Shack had their Trash 80 out there. The Trash 80 I liked way better. Anyway, talk to you later.